Hello PlayStation fans! Today we are revisiting the 2000 James Bond spin-off, 007 Racing, where John Cleese berates you for the entire game.
I don't believe it, 007.
When you sit down to watch an old Bond film, there are a few things that you expect to see. Bond getting laid.
There.
I thought you said he was with Dr. James.
Funny quips.
You have a nasty habit of surviving.
Well, you know what they say about the fittest.
Funny quips about getting laid.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Keeping the British end up, sir.
Silly gadgets.
Stinging in the rain.
That's not funny, 007.
And often a spectacular sequence involving a car. Then, of course, Bond getting laid in that car.
Well, let's toast your evaluation, shall we?
Of course, Daniel Craig's incarnation of the famous spy did away with several of these traits. But luckily for you, you can relive them all with the PS1 title 007 Racing. 007 Racing was released around the same time as the FPS adaptation of The World Is Not Enough. 2 weeks before in the US, and a month after in Europe. This game marks the seventh appearance of Pierce Brosnan's James Bond. The game included his likeness, but not his voice. Although, to be honest, his likeness is also questionable.
Careful, hotshot. I don't want to be digging your grave.
The story has the player take on the role of Bond, behind the wheel of several famous vehicles from the then 19 official films. Cars include the Aston Martin DB5, made famous in Goldfinger, the Lotus Esprit from The Spy Who Loved Me, and the BMW Z3 that briefly appeared in GoldenEye.
I didn't expect such a warm reception.
Each car is equipped with all the usual gadgetry and weapons issued by Q, who is voiced by John Cleese. As John Cleese is the only series cast member to reprise his role in the video game, the developers decided that they best get their money's worth.
For the love of country, 007, do hurry up!
No offense to Mr. Cleese, but we turned him off after a few missions into the game. Sorry. The game is a hybrid of Driver and Twisted Metal. Despite the name, there's not much actual racing, with missions often having the player complete various objectives against the clock, such as disarming mines, destroying enemies, or collecting mission-specific items. The plot centers around a European diplomat hijacking weapons. World domination, yada yada yada. You know the drill. The controls are awkward, but the game itself is fairly easy. Controlling any of the cars at speed with the D-pad is where you'll often run into trouble.
Please mind the finish, 007, you know what birds can do.
Oh, shut up, John! You collect power-ups on the levels that provide you with weapons, health, and gadgetry. Care is needed when picking up weapon power-ups because the game will switch to them immediately. So if you're happily firing your machine guns, then you'll fire off and waste any new Stinger missiles you obtain if you collect them, while still pressing the fire button. The final mission is by far the hardest in the game. You need to stop a plane from taking off by ramming its engines. Time and time again, we watch the plane fly away, until we realise that all you needed to do was slightly lean your car into each of the engines. No ramming involved at all.
Sorry, Doctor, but your flight's been cancelled.
We need to get out of here now!
Oh look, freaky CGI Bond is in the middle of the sea with a woman.
Think about it. She's out in the middle of nowhere with some dude she barely knows. You know, she looks around her. What does she see? Nothing but open ocean.
Ah, there's nowhere for me to run. What am I going to do? Say no?
Aside from the missions, the game also featured a multiplayer mode. Here, two players can fight in several small arenas. This was actually the only PS1 Bond game to have multiplayer.
Show some respect for the car.
In their review, IGN said, "It's not original, nor is it good looking. A decent little game, as long as you don't expect too much from it." Whereas GameSpot thought that 007 Racing isn't polished enough to fill the needs of objective-based driving game fans. So, as you may have predicted, the game received mixed or average reviews from everyone. But what were your memories? Andrew remembers that damn first level with no clue how to beat the helicopter. Only 10 minutes after the game has started and it's already impossible. You have to wait for the helicopter to fly away from you, which it rarely does, in order for your Stinger missiles to lock onto the target.
Well, he won't be hanging around.
Matthew remembers, "This game could have been great. It had the worst graphics and multiplayer. Would have been better if they'd have waited for PS2, as it had a lot of potential." And finally, just to show that not everyone hated it, another Matthew says, "I have two copies that I still play. The voice acting was great and the multiplayer mode is a blast." Although some people clearly have fond memories, most of your comments simply stated how bad the game was.
"Careful, 007, you're not invulnerable, and neither is that vehicle."
But what do we think? Well, several of the missions are pretty fun, but there's not enough here to keep you coming back. The game also featured many cutscenes where women congratulate your efforts, and are absolutely gagging for it. The type of thing you wouldn't find nowadays, but in the year 2000, nobody blinked an eye.
"Your performance calls for a celebration, Mr. Bond. What do you say we pool our resources?"
Did you own 007 Racing? Had you even heard of it before? Let us know in the comments below, and as always, thanks for watching.
Grow up, 007.
For more videos like this, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell to make sure you don't miss any videos in the future. Cheers!